morning and welcome to Warm Beach Church. I'm Abby.
And I'm Danielle.
And we're so glad you've joined us today. If you're new to Warm Beach Church, welcome. We would love for you to stop by Warm Beach Cafe for a free drink.
Our Warm Beach Cafe is open before both services. This is a great opportunity to grab a latte, espresso, or hot chocolate while supporting our students and youth ministry.
We hope you grabbed a copy of the sermon notes on your way in. This is a great way to follow along with the sermon and write down what God is speaking to you. You will also find a Connect card in the seat back in front of you. The Connect card is a great way to share prayer requests, ask questions, or connect with the pastor. You can fill it out and drop it in the offering box on your way out.
If you came prepared with a tithe or offering, we have a few different options for you. You can visit our website at wbfmc.org and click the Give button on the homepage, or you can give through our church app.
And if you brought your gift with you this morning, you can place it in the offering box at any time.
Let's worship Jesus together.
Good morning. Come on, let's try it again. Good morning. All right, we'll go with that. Well, it is good to be with you this morning. My name is Jake. I'm one of the pastors here, and just excited to spend time with you this morning. Want to share a couple things with you as we get started. One of the foundations of who we are as a church is we want to experience life in groups. And there are several ways that you can do that, where you can plug in and just get connected into the life of the church. One of which is coming up this next Saturday, so 6 days from now. It's going to be our men's breakfast. We're restarting them back up after the summer break. And we're going to be in here 8 o'clock in the morning. We're going to eat some breakfast. We're going to spend some time praying and reading God's word together. It's a lot of fun. And this is for guys of all ages. It doesn't matter if you are born like last week or you're on the other end of the spectrum. We want to have all guys come out and be a part of breakfast and drink some coffee with us. Some other ways coming up to get plugged in and to experience life in groups is we have several Bible studies starting up. Our Wednesday night programming is also starting up with something for everyone of all ages, youth, kids, adults, anyone. That's coming up. We have our Thursday morning women's Bible studies, our precepts, which is a group of ladies that dig deep into God's word. That starts up this Thursday. And then we have our other women's Bible study that starts up in a couple weeks in Upper Wesley. And just so much going on, ways to get connected and plugged in. We'd love to have you come out. If none of those sound interesting to you and you're curious what else there might be, there are Connect cards in the seats in front of you, and you can fill that out and say, hey, nothing you said made sense to me. Can we talk more about it? And we'll talk more about it. But let's start first by standing and saying hi to someone around us.
Good morning, church family. Let's worship the Lord together.
Grass. Lord my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and I have been saved from my enemies. As we sing this next song,
thank you. tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone.
Praise you because you are here with us now. We praise you because you're present with us every moment of every day. I just ask, Lord, that whatever it is that we are carrying, that, Lord, we would entrust that to you, that we would turn that over to you and to allow you to carry that for us. Lord, we thank you for your presence in our life. We thank you for your love and grace and mercy. And we ask, Lord, that we would rest in the truth of that, that whether we can only just acknowledge that in our minds, or Lord, we know that we know that. I ask, Lord, that you would meet each and every one of us exactly where we are, giving us exactly what we need. Lord, I ask your blessing over the message. I ask that as Pastor Morgan brings the word to us, that Lord, we would have ears to hear and hearts to receive what it is that you have for us, and that Lord, we would go empowered to take whatever next step it is that you are calling us to. And so Lord, we ask this all in your mighty name. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. It's good to be here with all of you. This past week, we have welcomed some new kids into the world. We had a new baby born in our church, not like literally in our church. That would be quite the eventful week. But in our church family, even in our own personal family, we had a little nephew born. His name is Caleb James. I just think that name is so strong, so powerful. I love it. It's like the strength of the Old Testament, strength of the New Testament with Jesus just crammed right there in the middle. And when I see babies, when I see little kids, as I watch them, I often ask the question, I wonder what he has been created for. I wonder what she has been designed for. I cannot wait to see God bring out of his children the design that he has for their lives as they become teenagers. And I watch them go into middle school and into high school, and I get to see them come into their fullness of their personalities and all the awkwardness that brings with it. Can I get an amen? Yeah, okay, it was kind of weak sauce this morning, but I love seeing the potential, right? And even as we get older, you know, I think we are on this constant journey of unpacking, what have I been designed for? What have I been created for? What is God's purpose in my life for me? And whenever I get discouraged and I think about, man, shouldn't I have this already figured out at 45? Should I have enough gray in my beard and on my head that I should have these questions answered? And then I'm reminded that so many men and women in Scripture lived so much of their lives before they fully understood what God had created them and designed them for. And so I give myself a little bit of a break with that. And this fall, this month, we're launching a new series called Designed for Life. And I don't know if you've ever thought about like your own life and what God has designed you for, what he's created you for. And isn't it true that whenever we meet someone, we get to know someone, one of the first questions we ask them is, what do you do? As if that is what defines who they are. And while what we do is a part of who we are, it is not the entirety of what God has created us for. And my hope is as we look at this series over the next 4 weeks, we as a church will begin to understand and unpack what God has designed us for, what his purpose is for our lives. I want to say this morning. You have been designed more for more than just coming to church on Sunday. Did you know that? Some people believe that the fulfillment of what it means to be a child of God is to show up when the church doors are open, to find your seat and make sure nobody else takes it, and to get your cup of coffee, and to enjoy. By the way, we have all these amazing seats right up here in front. We'd love for you to come and sit in one of those. But God has designed you for more than just to fill a seat on Sunday morning. And I think one of the biggest questions that gets asked of me is what does it look like to become a Christian, a child of God, to be saved, redeemed by the blood of Jesus? And then what's the purpose? Like what happens outside of just coming to church? And so we're going to launch a program this fall called Growth Track. And I'm excited about this because it's the path of discipleship for our people. And this is for those of you who have been coming to this church longer than I have. This is for those of you who are new or newer to our church, and you're wondering, you know, what is there beyond just coming to church on Sunday morning? And so we're going to be launching that in October. This series is really to lay out the groundwork for that. And we're just really excited about introducing that. I don't know if you play games in your home, like not video games. I'm talking like board games, card games. Are you games family? I grew up playing all kinds of games. My wife, Angela, she grew up playing all kinds of games. And as we raise our daughters, we love to play games with them. Card games, board games, you name it. We love to laugh and we love to compete. I love to win. I love to console my daughters when I do win. And teach them what life is really like. And, you know, when you play games, do you ever think about house rules? Do you ever think about how you've taken a game and you've adjusted the rules to suit your desires? When Angela and I first got married, we started playing games together, and we realized very quickly that what we thought were actual rules of the games were actually house rules that we, our families, had created. And there is a game in our home that is completely outlawed. Have you ever had that experience? Because we discovered that this game, when played, led to marriage counseling. Led to tears and frustration, and that was mostly me hovering in the corner with that. Because my house rules that I grew up with were different than Angela's house rules, and we found that those were oftentimes in conflict with each other. So this is what we did. The game, if you have ever heard of this game, is called Monopoly. We don't... Oh, I see that it's hit a bit of a nerve with some other people. You know what we did to find a solution to this problem, and it's led to years of blissful marriage? We got Monopoly Junior. And there's no more fighting or quarreling. It's a quick game. You can play it in 45 minutes, and the kids love it, except for when I win. And not that I lord it over them, but doesn't it help to know what the rules are to the game? And whenever we play a game, oftentimes when we think that a rule is a rule and we've discovered, no, that's actually a house rule, we find ourselves going back to the rules of the game and reading them. And it's the same as true with us in our relationship with God. God has actually set up rules for this life. He's actually set up a design, a purpose, a plan for this. It's not fun playing a game when you don't know what the parameters are. It's not fun playing a game when you don't know what the rules are, when you don't know how to win, when you don't know how to compete for the game. The same is true in our own lives. And so this morning, I just want to introduce to us this series, Designed for Life, because I believe that God wants us to know what the parameters, what the rules, what the goals, what the win looks like for his life that he's created for us. In John chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and he shares this verse with them. He says to them, "The thief, who is Satan, comes only to steal and kill and destroy. But I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." You see, the win for the life that God has designed for you and I is to have life, but not just some life, fullness of life. And that fullness of life only comes through Jesus Christ himself. And so as we unpack this series over the next 4 weeks, we're going to focus on this verse and how it impacts our life and how we can experience the fullness of life that Jesus has come to bring all of us. And it's counter to the life that the thief, that Satan, wants to come and to steal and kill and destroy. This world, I don't know if you've ever felt this way, but sometimes I wake up and I feel like I've just been kicked repeatedly by the world. And Jesus wants us to experience the fullness of his life, not just the hardships of this life. And so this morning, we are actually going to start right at the very beginning. We're going to start in Genesis chapter 1. And if you have your Bibles, I invite you to turn with me there and follow along as we read the creation story. This is how God created everything, the account of that, and how everything and everyone came into being. And this might be a familiar story for many, but it also might be the first time you're hearing it. And this is what God did when there was nothing but God. Verse 1, it says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, 'Let there be light,' and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness, and God called that light day, and he called the darkness night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, let there be a vault between the waters to separate water from water. So God made the vault and separated the water under the vault from the water above it. And it was so. God called the vault sky, and there was evening, and there was morning the second day. And God said, let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let the dry ground appear. And it was so. God called the dry ground land and gathered the waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to this, to the various kinds. And it was so. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seed according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed and according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good, and there was evening, and there was morning the third day. And God said, let there be light in the vault of the sky to separate the day from night, and let them serve as signs to mark the sacred times and days and years, and let them be lights in the vault of the sky to give light on the earth. And it was so. God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. It was funny to watch as people came in this morning. You didn't know quite how to handle the sun that was just kind of awkwardly positioned in the sky, and it was kind of red, and everyone's thinking, is this it? Are we going home? No, it's okay. We're not there yet that I know of. He also made the stars. God set them in the vault of the sky to give them light on earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate light from darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the water teem with living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the vault of the sky. So God created the great creatures of the sea and every living thing with which the water teems and that moves about in it, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them and said, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the water in the seas and let the birds increase on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, the livestock, the creatures that move along the ground, and the wild animals, each according to its kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that moved along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and every living creature that moves on the ground. Then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds in the sky and all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has the breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw all that he made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from his work. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating what he had done. This is an incredible story. I wish that I had the level of productivity that God has. I wish that I could start a project and have it finished 7 days later. Every project that I seem to start always costs more and takes more time, doesn't it? But not with God. God set out to intentionally design and create his creation, and he accomplished it in the time that he intentionally designed it to be accomplished, and then he rested. And the reason for this is because there is a profound truth here that we see at the very beginning of God's word that is carried all throughout Scripture, and it is this: everything God does is intentional. Everything that God does is intentional. There is no plan B with God. There is no mistake with God. God never wakes up in the morning and says, I wonder what I'm going to do today. God never says, oh, I probably should have done something different. God knows what he's going to do. He intends what he's going to do, and he does everything according to his plan. Let's recap the creation story, okay? We just read it. You have your Bibles. This is like an open book test here for you, but this is congregation participation this morning. So on day one, what did God create? I heard a lot of Charlie Brown mumbling there, so I'm going to assume you said light and darkness. God separated the light from the darkness. What about day two? What did God create? Sky and seas, water, bodies of water, great lakes, oceans. Day three, God created, we're standing on it. That's right, land. There we go. You guys need some more coffee this morning. On day three, three things that God created. If you're awake, you see me pointing up four. No, he created three things. What did God create? Nope, before we get to plants. Sun, moon, stars, there we go. Day five, he created what? Birds and fish. Day six, he created three things. Animals, people, which we got two in there, right? Who were the two people he created? There we go, Adam and Eve. And what did he do on day seven? Rested. And you're all thinking, I don't want this open book exam ever again. The easiest one, that's right. The answer is always Jesus. Just now take a moment and think about the order of God's creation. What would have happened if God had created the fish before he created the seas? Or the birds before God created the sky? Or animals and people before God created the land? Would it have made sense if God had created the sun, moon, and stars before he even created light? You see, the truth is that even in the creation story, we see such a level of intentionality and detail in how God creates things. And I think sometimes we just gloss right over that. We read the creation story and we're like, okay, God, got it. You created everything. I understand that. But what we don't understand always is that there's an order to things. There's a reason behind it. There's a will that is governing everything. And it's the same intelligent design and reason and order and will that exist in our own lives. And sometimes, if we're honest, do we not think that our lives are a little bit out of control? Do we not think that maybe sometimes things happen the way that they shouldn't happen, at least the way that we think they shouldn't happen? And the truth is either God is either intentional all the time or he's not. James tells us in his book that he's the Father above who doesn't change like the shifting sands. God is the same yesterday and today, and he will forever be today. He is the one constant that we can always trust on because everything that God does is intentional. The way you're created, the jobs you've had, the schools you've gone to, the teachers that are teaching you patience, the homes that you live in, the places that you exist, the time that you were born in. All of this is intentional because God is using you, creating you for a reason to see his purposes come to fruition. And so everything that God does is intentional, and we see that here in the creation story. And inside this story, we actually get a glimpse of what some of the winds are, or the rules are, or the house rules, if you were, of God's creation. We see three things that God intentionally designed us for. And these three things that I'm just going to introduce this morning are going to be the messages that come in the next 3 weeks. The first thing that God intentionally designed us for is to bear his image. God has intentionally designed you and I to bear his image. Have you ever seen a newborn baby? I've done this twice this week. I've already shared with you that there's been some new babies. The first thing I do is I look at that child and I think, like, who does that child look like? Like, you're looking to see, is there a resemblance in the baby, in the infant, in the newborn that exists there in the parents, right? You're trying to figure out which side of the family does he or she look more like? And, oh, there it is. I see it, right? And we look for the image that we have with each other in our children, and yet We all carry with us the image of God. God's creation is filled with a vast array of amazing, creative, and fearfully, wonderfully made images, isn't it? I mean, just take, for instance, the corpse flower. I don't know if any of us have one of these in our backyard, but this is a rather large flower. And the flower blooms infrequently and only for a short period of time. And so it gives off a powerful scent to help attract pollinators quickly and effectively. And the strong smell it emits resembles that of rotting flesh. Wouldn't you love that in your garden? Yet this is a creation of God. This is one of his images of his creation. Or how about the eye? This is another wonderfully created creation of God. This is the world's largest nocturnal primate and lives in the Madagascar rainforest. I can just see some of the kids saying after church this morning, "Mom, can we go get one of these?" You might be able to find one in the bushes. They look like possums. You just take one and away you go. Or how about this, the spiny devil katydid. It's covered with spines all over and lives in the Ecuadorian Amazon and gives off a high-pitched squeal whenever predators get too close, much like some of our little children that run around here. Their jaws also have the uncanny ability to draw blood if you get too close. They look cuddly, but they are not. The point here is that God's creation contains all kinds of amazing, wonderful, creative, funny, scary, and even humiliating types of images. But there's only one creation that bears the image of God, you and me. As one commentator writes, the fulfillment of the divine command is recorded in three brief sentences specifying the most significant aspects of the human existence, that we are created to bear his image, God's image. Verse 27, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Whenever things are repeated in Scripture, they're repeated for a reason. They're to emphasize what God is saying, and God is saying he wants there to be no mistake. No matter what part of yourself you wish you could change, no matter which talent or gift you wish you had, no matter what your history is, your background is, no matter what your mistakes are, God is saying, you have been created intentionally in my design. Not just out of the creativity of my mind and my will, but after, based on me, myself. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God intentionally designed us not only to bear his image, but he also intentionally designed us to be fruitful in everything we do. God created us to be fruitful, you and I. For some, it might mean to get married and have kids. Oftentimes, this verse here in Genesis 1 is used to show the validity of getting married and having kids, but that isn't the design and call for every single person. Paul himself, an apostle of Jesus, never got married, never had children, still was very much designed in the image of God and very much had purpose and meaning and had fullness of life. For others, it's to experience relationship and community, using our influence with others to be mentors, friends, surrogates, adopted families, an extension of God's grace. But God's command to be fruitful isn't just about family. We're going to unpack this in a couple weeks, but he says, be fruitful and fill the earth. The fruitfulness isn't exclusive to just filling the earth. He's saying, I've created you to be fruitful, and one of the expressions, just one, of this fruitfulness is filling the earth. But fruitfulness is so much more. He created us to be fruitful in the work we do, to create instead of destroy, to add instead of take away, to lift up instead of tear down. We are called to be fruitful in our jobs, in our play, and even in our rest. We are called to be fruitful in the words we use, the actions we take, and the legacies we leave. Even greater than all of this, God has also called us to be fruitful with the gospel, to be prepared to share his story, to love in such a way that people see God, and to pray like people's lives depend on Him. God has called us, designed us, created us to be fruitful, not just in a few things, but in everything we do. And the third thing that God intentionally designed us for that we see here in Genesis chapter 1 is He designed us to act as caretakers of His creation. It would be easy to read the creation account in Genesis and see the word rule, which is repeated multiple times, and assume that it means dominion, power, lordship. But there is only one Lord, and His name is... You know the answer to this. It's always Jesus. Let's try this again. There's only one Lord, and His name is Jesus. We don't need to take the place of Jesus. He's actually invited us in to be caretakers of His creation. He's entrusted us with the things that He's created. He's entrusted us with the people He's created. He's entrusted us with everything that He intentionally designed as His creation. God's command to rule is not an act as though we are in charge, but instead is to remember that it is God who is always in charge. My neighbor Dan has a whole lot of chickens. We used to raise chickens, and occasionally Dan will go away and go on vacation and need someone to help him with his chickens, and so he'll ask our girls or he'll ask myself to look after his chickens. I'll tell you this, that when we had chickens, our chickens never got looked after as well as Dan's chickens get looked after when he's gone. Why? Because I don't want Dan to come home and me to have to explain to him why one of his chickens, who they named, which you never name a food source, people, unless it's breakfast, lunch, or dinner. That's about it. I didn't want to have to explain to his little kids why their chickens died on my watch because they've entrusted me with this. Their chickens were treated like royalty. They got the best scraps from our table. I went over there multiple times to make sure that they were tucked in at night. Even my own children don't get that kind of care in our home. Why? Because I had become a caretaker of his chickens. And God has created you and I to act as caretakers of all of His creation. And when we get to that message in a few weeks, we're going to unpack what that actually looks like and how it actually impacts our lives. But God intentionally designed us to bear His image, to be fruitful in everything we do, and to act as caretakers for His creation. And the reason for this is because God has always known that he would need to send Jesus to redeem us. See, when you boil it right down to the bare minimum, and you look at this passage, and you see how God laid out an intentional plan for His people, knowing full well that we were just going to mess it up, God always knew He would need to send Jesus to redeem us. The amazing part of the creation story, and even greater than the account of God's intentional design for His creation, is the intentional design for His plan of redemption on full display in the very first chapter of the whole book of the Bible. No sooner had Adam and Eve sinned than God provided the first atoning sacrifice by providing clothing made from animals. If you continue to read on in Genesis chapter 2, you'll see the account there of Adam and Eve sinning for the first time. And as a result of their sin, they taste death for the first time. And they become aware of their nakedness, is what the Bible says. And so they run and they hide. And when God comes to walk with them in the cool of the day, as He was so accustomed to, they were hiding and deceiving God. And it's interesting, when you read that passage of Scripture, we often think that Adam's sin, or that the revelation he had was that he was naked. He was hiding from God because he was wanting to deceive God, that his deceit was the sin that he committed. And so God, at the end of that passage, when God takes Adam and Eve and places them outside of the garden, it says there that God fashioned for them clothes from animals. Up to this point, there had been no bloodshed in God's creation. And for the first time, animals were sacrificed for the atoning of Adam and Eve's sin, for the atonement of people's sin in this world. No sooner had Adam and Eve sinned that God provided the first atoning sacrifice by providing clothing from animals. No sooner had Adam and Eve tasted mortality and the death it brings, God proclaimed that there would be a day that he would send his son Jesus to crush the head of Satan. As God is doling out the consequences for the sin in chapter 2 and chapter 3, he tells them, he proclaims, he prophesizes that there will be a day when his son would crush the head of Satan, defeating sin and death forevermore. We see in the very first chapters of the God's word, his plan, not just for creation, but his plan for redemption. It's why Paul in Ephesians chapter 1 says this. He says, "Praise be to God, to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him, for God chose you and I in Christ Jesus before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight." Even before God created anything, even before he created us, he chose us to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, God predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one Jesus he loves. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put in effect when the times reached their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. This is the intentional design of God's creation laid out for us here. Even before the 7 days of creation, God intended for this. In him, verse 11, we were chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him, God, who works out everything in conformity with the purposes of his will, in order that we, who are the first to put our hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And it's so easy for us to get hung up on this idea of predestination. Like some get in and some don't, and God already knows, and so he doesn't care about those who don't. And lest any of us should begin to think that Paul intended us to believe that God's redemption was only available for a select few, he finishes this thought with this vital reminder in verse 13 and 14. "And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal." The gospel isn't just for a select few. The gospel is for everyone. And yes, God knows the outcome of everything because nothing surprises him and nothing changes his mind. And if God was only going to predestine a select few to be saved, then why didn't he just not start with creation at all? But God is such a gracious, merciful, loving, compassionate God. He doesn't wait to send his son back because he's tardy or late. He's waiting so that as many as possible can hear the good news of his gospel and respond to it this morning. God is waiting because he wants to mark you and I in him with a seal. The promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance unto the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. That's why when we sing a song like, "Come Holy Spirit, you are welcome here," matters so much. Because if we don't welcome the presence of the Holy Spirit, we are not in the presence of God. We are not marked with a seal in him. Our Holy Spirit is our inheritance. He is the one that is marching us towards eternity, marching us towards eternal life, marching us towards fullness of life, even here now in this life, to the praise of God's glory. See, God always knew that he would need to send Jesus to redeem us. He always knew. And yet he still created us. Because God loves you, and he loves me, And he has an intentional design for our lives. And he is not surprised by our sin. He is not surprised by our mistake. He's not surprised by our choices. He knew you would be here right now in this moment receiving his presence. He's led you every step of the way to this moment here right now. And this morning the invitation is this. I'm going to invite the worship team to come forward. And here's the invitation. You have it there on your handout. You see it on the screen. Be intentional this week. Say no to temptation. Say no to sin. You have the capacity to say to the enemy, not today, Satan. Not today. Why? Because we have the presence of the Holy Spirit in our life, and because his presence can give us victory over saying no to temptation. And some of us are dipping our toes in the deep end of sin. Some of us are thinking it's really not that big of a deal. Who's it hurting? No one knows about it. God will still love me. His grace abounds, right? We give the argument that Paul says that since grace abounds more, should we not sin more so we could experience more God's grace? And Paul says, by no means. Because if you really are full of God's grace, you would have no appetite for sin. And yet we allow temptation to hang around like a roaring lion, like a thief in the night, ready to take us. This week, be intentional and say no to temptation. Be intentional and choose God. Choose God. We are making choices every day, all throughout the day of our life, whether or not we're choosing God or we're choosing what this world has to offer. What would it look like if we were to intentionally choose God as God has intentionally chosen us? Intentionally be fruitful in your work, your play, and your worship. What would it look like if you went to work tomorrow, not dredging that it's a Monday and it's 4 days till Friday, or 2 days till Wednesday, or 1 day to taco day? But what if you actually went to work tomorrow, school tomorrow, and you thought, today is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice. And guess what? Be glad. What if we were fruitful in our work, in our play, and even in our worship? And what would it look like for us to be intentional to take care of what God has entrusted to you? Your homes, your lives, your cars, your possessions, your time, your money, your gifts, your talents. What would it look like if we were to intentionally take care of those things that God has created for us to use for his glory and for his kingdom? That's what God is calling us to. And that is when Sunday mornings, by the way, will really become what God has intended Sunday mornings to become. You see, church isn't intended to be the, I'm driving on fumes, I need to be filled up so I can handle the week. Church is intended to be that time when we gather to celebrate the goodness of God witnessed in our lives in every area that he has called us to be a time of celebration. That is what church has the possibility to be. And so let's live our lives with such intentionality that we intentionally walk and respond to God's grace and his gift of invitation to us in every place, in every way, in every moment. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for who you are. Thank you for inviting us here. Thank you for creating us. Thank you for making no mistake with our lives, no mistake with who you've called us to be, no mistake with who you're leading us to be. God, thank you for having a plan from the very beginning, even before the beginning of time. Thank you for loving us in such a way that when we messed up your plan, you weren't surprised by it. You already had a solution. God, I thank you that you sent your son Jesus for us. I thank you that you allow us to live in the presence of your Holy Spirit, that we can say no to temptation, that we can have the wisdom to respond and choose you. God, I thank you that you've called us to these places of work and play and even worship. And I ask that you would help us to just become more aware of how we can do that with more intentionality. And God, I pray that you would help us to know what it means to take care of that of which you've entrusted us with, and that we would honor you and glorify you in all of that. In your name we pray, amen.
Church, would you stand as we close our time in worship? This next song that we're gonna sing is an older song, and at least older for me, but This song is very, very near and dear to my heart. It was one of the songs that I did in my senior recital. And the reason why I say that is because this song really reminds me of God's love. And, you know, in times of difficulties, in times of when you're walking through that valley of shadow of death, it reminds us that the Lord is never going to let go of you. It's hard sometimes to sing it with belief, but I feel like we're called to do that. And again, I'm going to say this. If you're not there, if you feel like you're in that valley of shadow of death, it's okay. It's completely okay. Let other people sing over you. You don't have to just, but the only thing I ask is like, just come with a posture of openness to the Lord. Say, Lord, here I am. I'm struggling in. So, would you join in worship, however that may be for you? Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. In the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back. I know you are near, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, until then.
God was as intentional with his creation as the Bible says he is, which he is, then he's going to be as intentional with your salvation as he's promised to be. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. God has promised to walk this journey with you and to give you everything that you need to see it through. This morning, we are called into that same level of intentionality, to be as intentional as he is intentional. We have a people back in our prayer corner that would love to be able to pray with you. And maybe one of the next steps for you this morning is just simply going back and having someone pray over you, pray into you, helping you to see how you can be more intentional. I'm excited for the series and see how it unpacks and unfolds over the weeks to come. And so I hope that you'll come back next week. We look forward to worshiping God with you again next Sunday. Thank you for being here. Have a great day. You're dismissed.